The Pirates ship is smooth sailing once again for Seton Hall men's basketball. After an alley-oop walk-off gave the Pirates a victory over Butler, they rolled their momentum into the next game, dominating the St. John's Redstone from start to finish in front of their biggest crowd of the season. On the flip side, the women's basketball team also encountered the Redstorm, but they weren't as lucky. I'll be joined on this beautiful stage by Christian Gardner and Justin Morris to recap last week's action and let you know what you can expect from the men's and women's basketball teams down the stretch. We will also touch on some other spring sports around the South Orange campus. My name is Wilnir Louis, and this is Hall Talk. Welcome back to Hall Talk here on PTV. I'm joined by my lovely panelists of Christian Gardner and Justin Morrison. We might as well just get straight into the action because we have a jam-packed episode here for you today. Seton Hall, after going 0-2 last weekend, they were able to bounce back and have a 2-0 weekend of their own, being able to beat Butler off a walk-off alley-oop to Sandro Mamukelashvili and then be able to dominate the St. John's Red Storm. We talked about the Butler game last week because that was a Wednesday game, so let's just get straight into that St. John's game. Again, a wire-to-wire victory, being able to go into halftime with a lead, and that's really good for Seton Hall down the stretch.
Yeah, the Pirates just that night had such a great balanced attack. They had five players finish with double figures. And, I mean, if you can have great minutes like that, there's no way that you can't have a bad night like that. But I have to say that the big difference that I've seen in the last couple weeks is the body language with this team. I feel like you see them against Creighton and Xavier. They get down on themselves, and you see heads down. But really, they got that swagger back and confidence to be significant in putting in great minutes.
Yeah, I completely agree with you, Christian. I think the one thing that you really pointed out that made a whole lot of sense was that balanced offensive attack that we really saw. Like you said, five guys in double figures. Saw Jared Roden with 14 points, Sandro Mamukelashvili with 16. Miles Powell had 18 himself, did lead the team in scoring, but he really struggled in that first half. But it's really about getting the other guys involved that's really going to determine how far this team does go in March. Only two games left on the seat. Well, three, if you include three games left on the season from the regular season right now, but everyone is focused on March. Everyone is looking at what they're going to do in the Big East tournament and then moving on to the big dance in the actual NCAA tournament. And I think it's not just Miles Powell, but the guys around him also that are going to make this team and really determine whether or not they go far.
Yeah, this is a team, again, that played in front of their biggest home crowd of this season. And for Seton Hall, they had a game against Michigan State that was ranked third in the nation at the time. So for all of those fans to come out on that Sunday afternoon to support this team, again, three games down the stretch, and this is a St. John's team that's not that great in conference play. They're at the bottom of the conference, but there's still some things that you might be able to take from that game going down the stretch. I want to know a couple of things that you guys think that will help Seton Hall in this game down the stretch against these three behemoths of teams.
Well, as I was saying, it's the complete team. When you have Shavar Reynolds coming off the bench, being just such a great defensive player as he is, and Miles Cale, if he can chip in how he was doing against St. John's, right, 10 points from him, I mean, you can't ask for more from him. But Quincy McKnight, you can't say enough about him. He's just a floor general out there. He had 6 assists against St. John's and 18 points against Butler. He's just been leading the Pirates so far. I think when he is having a great night, so are the Pirates.
Yeah, and honestly, a lot of people kind of looked at that stat line from Q in the game against St. John's and were worried about it. And I was sitting there relaxing, chillaxing the whole time, like, hold on, wait a minute. Do you guys forget his role? Q is definitely a scorer. Q can put up eons of buckets, but his main job is to get the other guys involved. So like you said, his assist total was perfectly fine with me. You mentioned MC coming off the bench, Miles Kalen getting those 10 points. That's the most points he's actually had in a while, and the highest shooting percentage numbers as well, 50% from the floor at 3-for-6. So I think Coach Willard really juggling up that lineup to see who can come off the bench, and also just switching around roles and giving guys different looks at different times gives them a whole different look that makes them really dangerous going into March.
Yeah, I think, like you said, switching up the lineup, Miles Kale, he has been a little wishy-washy this season, definitely, but in the game against St. John's with 10 points and, of course, that 360 slam that he had at the end of the game, that's something that could really boost your confidence. And, of course, Quincy McKnight just being a defensive player as he is and Miles Powell being the prolific offensive outing that he's able to have night in and night out. But after that St. John's game, in the post-game conference, Kevin Willard said that Quincy McKnight and Miles Powell has been dealing with a little tendonitis, you know, possibly a little wear and tear. So you kind of wonder if this is going to concern you down these next three games against Marquette, against Creighton, and against Villanova.
I think it takes a lot more to take those two great players off of the court. They want to play for this team. They're hungry. But, I mean, if they have some pain while shooting, like their shooting stroke could slow them down. But they have so many different ways to score and get to the basket. They're not afraid to drive. They can go and get an easy layup just as easy as they can shoot from behind the arc. So I'm not worried about it at all.
There's been a couple times actually this season where these two guys, Quincy McKnight and Miles Powell, have both been mentioned as far as injury talks are concerned. Every single time, there was not a problem whatsoever. So you talk about the Michigan State game, goes into that. Oh, bum leg, you heard it against Wagner, he's limping. You go into the week heading up to that. Monday, he's shooting around. Tuesday, oh shoot, he's walking when we thought he was on a crutch before. And then the actual game drops 37 points. Same thing with the concussion, he gets hurt. You know, he's out for a couple weeks after that Rutgers game, but then after that, continues to put up huge scoring outputs. Had a little bit of some shaky game shooting-wise, but I don't think it's going to be a real problem. Same thing with Quincy McKnight as well. We saw him go down with the injury, and I believe that was the Xavier game when he was really on the court for a while, and that kind of took the entire breath out of the crowd. Came back the next game and had a great performance. So tendonitis, injuries like that, we're going to see that throughout the season. There's a lot of wear and tear, especially as we get closer to March. But I don't think it's anything to worry about. Those are two of the toughest guys on the roster, period. And if anybody's going to play through injury, it's going to be those two.
Yeah, I mean, Quincy McKnight, he has been down with injuries time in and time out in this season. And, of course, Miles Powell, he had an injury early on in the season, was able to come back and score 37 against Michigan State. And like you said, the concussion, coming back from that and scoring 30-plus as well. And I think what also helps Seton Hall is just de facto bye week that they have. They played St. John's last Saturday, and then they're going to be on the road to play Marquette this Saturday. So they don't have that midweek game, so right, able to rest up a little bit and not having to go at least as hard in practice early on in the week. And for Seton Hall, they're coming into this week ranked 13th in the AP polls, and you know, you look at that ranking and you're like, that's a great ranking for Seton Hall, just the way that they're able to fluctuate. But then you look at who's above them. You have right, Villanova at 12, and you have Creighton, you know, up there at the top 10. And I just want to know, it's kind of weird that Seton Hall has been showing that they're the best team in the Big East, but you still have two Big East teams that are ahead of them.
Yeah, I agree, and I think Villanova is usually that team that you're going to look at as a, you know, one of the top competitors with Seton Hall. So you go into rankings, Villanova actually did win their last game. So I was surprised to see them ahead of Seton Hall. I was also surprised to see Creighton ahead of them too, but Creighton has been streaking. I would say I would put Creighton above the Hall just because of the fact they have been streaking and the Hall did lose two games before this. W at St. John's, but there's no question about it. Seton Hall is the best team in the Big East. I don't think anyone can really debate that, and even the coaches before the season started said this is the team that we think is going to be better than our team, and granted, you can't vote for yourself in the preseason Big East polls because I'm sure a few coaches would, but at the same time, they looked at Seton Hall and said this is the mammoth, this is the team that we feel like we have to beat, and so when you look at the rankings, to be honest, I'm not even paying attention to that. We all saw it, and even Miles Powell said that's that lucky number 13 that we're coming in, so I don't think they're too unhappy about the rankings, but everyone knows they're the best team in the Big East as of right now, in my opinion, and I don't think the rankings are going to bother them too much.
I completely agree. I mean, Creighton is a fantastic team, and they deserve to be in the top 10. They're one of the best offenses in college basketball right now, but Villanova being above the Hall, I don't know. I think the Hall controlled that game out in Philadelphia for all 40 minutes of that. But even Maryland being number 9, kind of, they're a shaky team. On Wednesday night, they played Minnesota and just escaped in Minnesota for a team that's 13-13 coming into that game. So, I mean, we'll see moving forward, but I think the Pirates are much more focused on bigger things than just being number 13.
Pirates also beat Maryland, so and without that's without Sandro and Miles too. So
yeah, you talk about the Pirates, you know, focusing on big things, and what cannot be bigger than Romario Gill being named a semifinalist for the Naismith Men's Defensive Player of the Year. Him, just the growth that he's had from last year to this year, averaging 3.4 blocks per game. And teams at Seton Hall have played, you know, the coaches have been saying how much Romario Gill really means on a defensive side for the Pirates, how he's able to, you know, make shots a little bit difficult for point guards and, you know, forwards to drive into the lane. So for him to get recognized on a national level to be a semifinalist, a great award, being joined alongside Aaron Thompson as the only two Big East players to really be nominated for this award.
I don't think there's been a game this year that no one has, like, said the name of Romario Gill and how big he is and how tall he is. I mean, he has, I believe, 93 blocks on the year. I mean, just such a great year for Romario Gill.
Yeah, definitely. And I think that's one of the things that separates Seton Hall when we talk about them going into March is, okay, let's take a few years ago, for example, you have Isaiah Whitehead, who was a five-star recruit, great player for the program. But what we talked about was don't really have the interior defense, don't really have the big men rebounding. Same thing, move on. Andrew Delgado's their star player, rebounding, block shots, presence inside, scoring. Well, Seton Hall doesn't really have the shooting. Then you go last year, Miles Powell, best player in the Big East, arguably shooting, but Seton Hall doesn't necessarily have everything around them that's going to bring them to the top. This year, Ramal Gill is what sets this team apart. It's Quincy McKnight with his assists. It's Miles Powell with the scoring. It's guys like MC, Shavar, energy guys, and it's Ramal Gill inside just completely, not only blocking so many shots, 3.4 is a huge amount, but changing shots. That's one stat that I really want to focus on is how many shots he just completely changes and makes guys not even want to shoot at the rim because they're so scared of his presence. So this is what really is making this team as complete and as scary as they can be headed into March is the fact that you have such a presence inside with Ramal Gill that's averaging as many blocks as he is, but is also in the heads of the opposing teams in the interior as well.
Listen, we could probably talk about the men's basketball team for probably 30, 40, 50 minutes, but the women's basketball team, they're on campus as well, and they suffered a heartbreaking loss against the St. John's Red Storm on Saturday. 77-76 was the final score in that game, and this was a game that they were up by double figures, but in the second half, St. John's was able to control the game, and Correa was able to control the game for the Red Storm. I mean, she had 19 points in the third quarter alone, and again, Seton Hall was able to at least try to come away with the victory. They had an opportunity at a last chance layup, but a couple of unlucky bounces and the ball rimmed out. So for Seton Hall, again, this is a team that's trying to make their push to not play in that first week or first day, excuse me, of the Big East tournament, as well as maybe make a push into the NCAA tournament. But with a loss like that, it kind of, you know, minimizes their margin and their error.
Yeah, for the Pirates that night, great night for the starters. Alexis Lewis, 22 points. Shadeen Samuels, 19. Elmore was 16. But there's just absolutely no production from the bench. Only 3 bench points for the Pirates that night. That can't cut it for you.
Yeah, and you talked about the scoring that the Pirates had, but double-doubles for each of those players you just mentioned in the double digits with rebounds, too. You talk about Shadeen Samuels, Alexis Lewis, and Des Elmore, but you mentioned the bench. That's really the core nucleus of this team, are those 3 players that you just mentioned. But as far as going into the remainder of the season, they've got 2 games left. They've got Xavier, and they've got another one after that. There's really just a big question mark surrounding this team. And if you look at the standings in the Big East, it's DePaul at the top. You know, you have Marquette, and you have Butler right below them, and then just this big, gigantic 9-7 slew of teams that Seton Hall is, and that's where Seton Hall falls. So if you're looking at March and going forward, NIT is really looking like it's going to be a lot higher of a likelihood than the NCAA tournament just because of how they fare during the regular season.
Yeah, but this is still a team, like you said, they have 2 games left. They have Xavier, who's at the bottom of the conference. I believe they only have 2 wins in the whole season. And then you have the Butler team that, like you said, is right there at the top of the conference, currently sitting third. So Seton Hall, they still can maybe make a push for the NCAA tournament, but they're going to have to win these next 2 games at home inside of Walsh Gymnasium. What are they going to have to do to at least secure those 2 victories?
I mean, you got to rely on your Big East all-first team preseason, Shadeen Samuels. Shadeen Samuels has been the leader for this team all season. She was leader for the team last season. But I think what really set her apart this year is really her leadership skills. And she did go down with an injury, so that hampered her scoring ability. But if you're looking for scoring, you're going to have to look towards her, Alexis Lewis, and then Des Elmore for the backups. But I think it really starts with Shadeen Samuels. She's the heart and soul of that team.
Well, you benefit a lot from being back in Walsh Gymnasium. They fared a lot better while at home. But you're going to need a lot more production on defense. They gave up 3 20-plus scorers in the last 2 games. That can't cut it, and you're just going to need way more production from the bench. And I'm looking at Barbara Johnson. She's the X factor for this team. Only 3 points in that last time out against St. John's. If she's scoring, then the Pirates can have a great night.
Yeah, you can't look past anybody in the Big East. Again, Xavier, even though their record might not be good, they're still going to try to come into Walsh Gymnasium and play upset. And then again, Butler, being third in the conference right now, they have shown time in and time out that they are a good team to play. So it's going to be very interesting in Walsh Gymnasium. But I want to ask you, do you think that Seton Hall could possibly fall in that 7th spot and play the first day? Because it's going to be a little difficult if they play that first day versus being one of the top 6 teams and then having that bye day.
It's very likely for me. Justin, you brought up that logjam all at 9-7. Right. And with Creighton and St. John's, I mean, both of those teams, They're looking probably go 1-1 in these last two games, and I think the same could be said for the Pirates. So I think they're staying probably right around where they are and could be playing that first weekend.
It's definitely possible, and as far as from a talent perspective, I think the Pirates are ahead of both of those teams that you just mentioned, Christian. I think it really just comes down to performance under pressure and playing, like you said, and also defense. You can't give up, and that's one of the things that really helped them in the games that they've won is their defense. When Seton Hall wins as far as points off of turnovers, when Seton Hall is winning in the steals margin, when they're winning as far as just turnovers, period, they're usually going to win the game because they're able to get out in fast break and get easy transition points. And also the bench has to step up as well, too. But I think as far as talent, Seton Hall's got the best just pure scorers and pure players maybe in the conference.
I think, of course, there's a possibility. I don't think it's going to happen, though, because for that to happen, Seton Hall would have to have an 0-2 weekend or a 1-1 weekend, and every other team in the Big East is going to have a 2-0 weekend. So, of course, there's a possibility anything can happen in the Big East, but I think Seton Hall, they're going to finish in that 1 or 1-6 range in the standings. So, before we end off Hall Talk here, of course, there's other sports that's going on in the spring, Tom. We have softball, we have baseball, golf, swimming, and diving. So with the limited time that we have left here on Hall Talk, I want you guys just to talk about, you know, one of those spring sports that's happening right now on the campus of Seton Hall.
Well, swimming and diving, their season's just about wrapping up here. They're in the Big East Championship right now out in Queens. So if you can get out there, there should be their last meet is today when this show is coming out. So maybe you can get out there, root for the Pirates.
Always rooted for the Pirates in every facet of it, but half the baseball guy for life, have to look at baseball. Really, they lost 3-4 against the nationally ranked Wake Forest team, and then after that went 17-1 against Milwaukee. Milwaukee's not the best opponent, but this team was really picked to finish pretty high in the Big East as far as Big East preseason polls go as well. And, you know, we always talk about the basketball team and how good they can be. The baseball team is looking pretty good with this newly renovated O&T Carroll Field, too. So I got to give a quick shout-out to the baseball team off to L.A. in sunny California right now to go face off against USC. So enjoy that because we'll be in the cold shaving our butts off.
I mean, definitely shout-outs to those two teams, the baseball team as well as the swimming and diving team wrapping up their season. But I want to touch on golf and more specifically Andres Acevedo. He has been named to the Big East men's golfer of the week, and he has been great in their last time out in the 2020 La Jolla Intercollegiate Tournament. He was able to tie 13th among 112 golfers that was out there. So wow. He has been showing true Pirates pride, and the fact that he was able to do that and get tagged with that award, I think, is very great of him. But that will do it for us here on Hall Talk, for Christian Gardner and Justin Morris. I'm Wilnir Louis saying sayonara, so long, and see you later.